Morning. Well, I'm glad to be here. Thank you for that nice introduction, Murray. Before we get started, just a quick, sense of where everybody's from. I know it's folks from all over the place. So how many from Ontario? And then everybody else outside Ontario? Who's the furthest away?
UBC, Vancouver, and is on one side of the country, and McGill, Montreal, the other side of the country.
Well, okay. Great. And one thing Murray didn't mention, actually, I was a NSERC scholarship recipient after undergrad, and that was part of what took me to Stanford. So I have a lot of appreciation for the NSERC program. Today I'm going to talk about really, combustion and what's driving, where we are today and where we're going in the future. And I thought I'd just start with kind of a reflection of where we are today compared to where we were. If you were to go in a time machine and imagine you went to the beginning of the 1900s and think about how would you move, how would you get power, what was the state of the world, the first powered flight didn't happen until the Wright brothers in 1903, and that was a reciprocating engine that created the power for the wooden propeller. And that was, of course, a very short flight. So if you wanted to go from Washington to Tokyo, it was about 3 months. So the world was pretty big. And it was a steamship or something like that. If you think about what happened in the middle of the 1900s with the development of the Whittle engine, and then that technology came over to the US. The first US jet engine got made in 1941. And then a pretty rapid pace of development. Supersonic propulsion in the 50s and 60s, breaking the sound barrier not just once, but then going to Mach 2. If you look at ground-based power, we went from, the sort of Industrial Revolution really started with steam technology, but it wasn't until, the late 40s that we moved on to gas turbine cycles, and combustion became inside the engine as opposed to an external boiler. So if you think about that progression, and then if you think about where we are sort of today, in 2003, the largest commercial aircraft engine was the GE90-115B. That's still the largest engine today. And it became very big because it wanted to power the 777 for Boeing with just two engines. Up until then, we had four engines, like on the 747. So, and now, 100 years later, Washington to Tokyo in something like 12 hours. So, just an amazing transformation that's happened. And then you say, well, what's going to happen next? Where are we going? And that's really the purpose of the next next hour and a half. More efficient, lower emissions, fuel flexible. Those are the themes that I see again and again as we look to the future. And, will we get to supersonic transport? I think there's a lot of interesting questions around that. But obviously, this, people have a need to move, and they want to move fast. So I do see that as a potential on the horizon. So before I go into a lot of detail, I want to give you a pitch. And I apologize, it's a little bit of a sales pitch. So I do work for GE, and I don't want to oversell that. But there's some great technical content in here. And it really sets up sort of the most modern engines and some of the cool combustion technology. So in spite of the sales pitch, I wanted to share this with you.
GE's always been on the cutting edge of combustion technology, but quite simply, with the introduction of GE TAPS technology and the GNX engine, we've changed the game when it comes to NOx emissions. Although not as well known as greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide, NOx, or oxides of nitrogen, produced at high altitudes can also affect climate change. Aircraft are only a very minor source of the world's NOx. A fraction of the leading contributors, such as cars, trucks, farm machinery, and construction equipment. International regulations set standards for acceptable levels of emissions produced by aircraft during landing and takeoff, but this accounts for only a small part of emissions produced during a flight. En route or cruise NOx make up the vast majority of the total emissions. Until the introduction of TAPS technology, designers focused on the regulating low altitude, landing and takeoff emissions, and accepted the resulting cruise emissions. GE TAPS enabled the designers to minimize both the low altitude emissions and the high altitude cruise emissions. In fact, GE TAPS reduces cruise NOx emissions by more than half compared to the prior best-in-class combustors. Also consider this. NOx is produced in the engine's combustor when the fuel is burned at high temperatures. Quite simply, the higher the temperature, the more NOx is produced. Efforts to reduce the amount of fuel burned during a flight have resulted in an increase in temperature at the inlet to the combustor. While this has reduced carbon emissions, which is good, it's had an adverse effect on NOx emissions, which is bad. GE TAPS technology has enabled a reduction in cruise carbon emissions while at the same time reducing NOx emissions, the best of both worlds, as it were. The secret to success of the GE TAPS combustion system are the TAPS fuel air mixer and the computer controlled fuel system. The fuel air mixer creates two different flame zones within the combustor, while the controller calculates the amount of fuel and air that needs to be burned, measures the temperature of air entering the combustor, then precisely controls the distribution of fuel within the two TAPS combustion zones to keep each flame just hot enough for clean burning, but cool enough to prevent the production of high levels of NOx. These features quite simply revolutionize the combustion process, much like the fuel injection system that replaced the traditional carburetor to produce much lower emissions in your car. The combination of the GE TAPS combustion system, along with other technology on the GE NX engine, results in one of the most advanced engines available today.
Great. So that engine, GE NX, goes on the 787 aircraft. So I don't know how many of you have flown on a 787. It's still pretty new. But this is one of the engines that's on that. And it is the first lean burn combustion system for aviation. So I'll talk a little bit more about that. But I wanted to start very sort of high level here, and then we'll work into details, and just talk about global trends. So if you're thinking about engines and gas turbines of the future, you know, what's important? So fuel prices, that's on everybody's mind. When you buy an airplane ticket, when you pay your electric bill, you know, you're indirectly paying for that fuel, and that drives a lot of behavior. Greenhouse gas awareness, we're all becoming much more aware of that and the implications. And so that drives a lot of our behavior. And the nice thing is, in many ways, fuel price and greenhouse gas are both pointing in the same direction. So that's a positive in my mind. Clean air regulations, huge. That's really what drives the industry. Industry needs a prod from government if it's going to, you know, make things cleaner. And the regulations, you know, certainly support that, and all around the world. Unconventional oil and gas, this is really changing the game. It's going to affect fuel prices, but it's also going to affect the kind of fuel that we burn and have a big impact. And then, of course, you know, related to the fuel side is the growth of biofuels. So just to go a little deeper in each of them, you know, combustion really is what moves and powers our world. If you think about, you know, how you get from here to there, if you think about what keeps the lights on, in the main, it is combustion related. There are new technologies. Of course, we have solar for power. We have, you know, wind. If I look at cars, we're getting into electric. But then you got to say, where did that electricity come from? In aviation, because of the unique need for high power density, I think we're going to be taking fuel and burning it for a long time. The value of taking oxygen from the air is very important to a propulsion system. So, you know, the global fuel usage has gone up. And what's interesting about this chart, you know, it shows some of the distribution, coal, renewables, and so on. What's really interesting about this chart is that it's sort of linear. And yet, if you think about the development of the world and the industrialization processes that have happened, it's really accelerated since the middle of the century. And probably in the last 30 years, it's accelerated around the world. And the only reason that's not a steeper curve is all the work done to make us more efficient. So, you know, that's been a big deal. Today, I'm going to focus on three areas that are familiar to me. Combustion for gas turbines, either ground-based or for aviation. And then also I'll talk a bit about reciprocating engines. That's also very important. But I'll talk about big reciprocating engines, you know, where one cylinder makes 400 horsepower. So these are big engines. But they do power our world in ways that, you know, are amazing. So if you look at, you know, trends in terms of fuel prices, this is a plot. The dark green is the actual fuel price. The light green is normalized for inflation. So you can see that, you know, in the early days, This is going back to, last century. Fuel was very expensive. In fact, fuel came from things like whale oil. You know, that we didn't know about there was fuel under the ground. But once we learned about fuel under the ground and learned how to extract it, fuel prices, were low and pretty stable for a long time. And it wasn't until the price shocks of the 70s that really, changed people's perceptions. And then, that came down. That was kind of a bubble. But then with the explosive growth around the world, that again, has driven up prices. And frankly, I don't see that really coming down. I think that's a reality that we all have to live with. So that's driving innovation for efficiency and the need for different types of fuels. Greenhouse gas awareness, the same story here. This is just a plot of the emissions per year. And this is, less linear than the use of fuel. So there's other sources of greenhouse gases. This very busy chart in the middle, I'm not going to go through it, but just kind of saying if you start with coal, natural gas, some of the things I had in the previous chart, what you end up with that's important for greenhouse gases is CO2, which is a big deal. But we're also very worried about methane slip and methane emissions. And then there's a number of smaller things. And NOx and how it interacts with the atmosphere is also important. So again, this awareness and the concern over this is also driving the need for efficiency and alternative fuels. The other one is clean air regulations. If you look at this, the first one is a picture just of a city where you see this brown smog. That's NOx. So that's why I'll talk more about NOx, but that's obviously a big deal. And then if you look at China today, these are just pictures I grabbed about China last year. And if you look at that satellite image, you sort of see white clouds, but you see this gray stuff. That's not a cloud. That's smog. So, clean air is a big deal. And everywhere, societies are concerned. North America's been really leading the world together with Europe on emissions. But I think every country in the world now is adopting standards. And one of the main indicators of the continued concern, a lot of financing of big projects around the world depends on World Bank financing. And they are in the middle of going through reducing allowable NOx levels. So this is just another example of how, the world just won't tolerate dirty combustion. And it's our job, if you're going to become a combustion engineer and work in this field, your job is to make sure we minimize the negative effects. The other part of this is, as I said, we're getting very clever. We're moving to this age of sort of, I'll call technical fuels. So things like tar sands is part of that story, but a big part of it is shale gas. And this is just a chart showing, really in the last less than 10 years, how the proven reserves based on the gas, this is just in the US, has jumped enormously. And then based on those proven reserves, the production is ramping up. And there's really not an end in sight. So if you look at how big these shale formations are and how widely distributed around the world they are, this is going to be a reality, and it's going to drive behavior. And what's interesting is, although they are getting liquids and condensates by this method, so that's helping the liquid fuel side, we're getting more gas faster. So we've always thought of gas as a fuel for industrial processes, maybe for power generation. There's now thinking, hey, what about this for transportation? And I'll talk more about that. And then, of course, the growth of biofuels. And, there's a lot of interest in biofuels, but, it's a mixed story, frankly. You can see, there was a lot of growth from 2000 to about 2010, and it's kind of leveled off. I think fuel, they're expensive, and things like unconventional gas and oils, the competition. And then you get into the whole food or fuel debate. So biofuels, I think, is going to be important, but the rate of adoption, is going to be sensitive to those external factors. But from the point of view of combustion, how do we handle that? How does it burn? Do we understand it? Is that good or bad for the equipment that we design? So those are the three areas where we talk about drivers for change. And if I just take a moment, I don't know how much all of you remember your sort of first year thermo, but I thought I'd just take a moment and walk back on some of the key parameters, because this is really fundamental to what's happening. And when we think about next generation equipment, we need to think about the basic cycles. So, you know, a gas turbine, whether it's for aviation or for ground-based power, is basically what's shown here. So it's a compressor, a combustor, and a turbine. The compressor squeezes the air, raises its temperature and pressure. We take that preheated air, sometimes very hot, and we add fuel. And depending how we add the fuel, that has a big impact on the amount of emissions that you make. And then you expand those hot gases through a turbine. So, you know, there's two ways to think about it, PV diagram, TS diagram. Is this all kind of familiar? So the important thing about this chart is when you look at what are your things that you can control, what are the trends? The trend is to increase pressure ratio. So what does that mean? If I look at, I'll use my mouse here. So if I look at this TS diagram, going from 1 to 2 is the compression state. And the main driver for equipment over the last 50 years has been to go to higher compression ratio. That was originally the barrier to developing a gas turbine. Frank Whittle spent the decade of the 1930s learning how to improve the efficiency of compression and to get higher level of compression. So the whole technology, both centrifugal and axial compressors, has really been, you know, pretty new. We didn't have that before 1930s. And it's remarkable how far we've come. So we have engines now, you know, the GE&X engine that I told you is up in the 40 compression ratio, and we have modern engines that are going well beyond that. So you know, that's the fundamental part. And if you look at a TS diagram, it makes sense. I'm going to get more area under the curve when I do that. But there's consequences. You know, one of the consequences of having higher pressure ratio is that the temperature of the gas is hotter. So if I need to use some of that air to cool my combustion liner and my turbine components, now I have it's hotter. So if a material limit's the same and it's gotten hotter, this is a real challenge. So, you know, that's one thing. And then of course, if I add fuel and burn, that's the state 3 on the TS diagram. And as I increase, you know, that temperature, I get more efficient as well. So, you know, those are the key drivers, the compression ratio, the firing temperature. And if you look at, you know, this is a couple of charts I just pulled. One's general sort of efficiency versus compression ratio. And you can see it goes up. And you can also see that it kind of flattens out. And this is a, you know, this is the world we live in. When it was new technology 50 years ago, it was kind of easy to make improvements. We're now in a world where we're on the flatter part of the curve. And that drives, again, need for other thinking. But if we do look at the impact on, this is a plot, it's maybe hard to read, but combined cycle efficiency, there's different technology curves here. This starts 1970 to 2005. And so-called E-class combustion technology was in the, if you took the gas turbine and you married it to a bottoming cycle, so a steam turbine or a Rankine cycle, together that would be on the order of 45 to almost 50% efficient. And that was one technology curve. There was a big increase in firing temperature, different materials, different cooling technologies, different combustion technology. And that moved us up as an industry up to so-called F-class technology. And that gets you up to in the 50s. Now the world for ground-based power generation is up with the sort of H-class equipment. And here we go. And that's pushing 60%. So the most modern plants today are around 60%. And you know, a chunk of that is from the gas turbine, a chunk of that is from the bottoming cycle. So the main message here is, you know, how do you deal with higher firing temperature? How do you deal with higher pressure ratio if you're designing a system? If we look at the reciprocating engine, I want to switch gears a little bit. And I think you're all familiar with four-stroke engines, but there's some fundamental different types of four-stroke engines. And there's sort of different DNA. And I'm not going to go through them all, but I think you're all aware of two-stroke diesel engines or two-stroke spark-ignited engines, where it's just two strokes. And I'm not going to talk about those because, frankly, they're not as clean burning. So four-stroke is really the method, the cycle of choice, and that's what's depicted here. And the key thing about, you know, reciprocating engines, I can either, depending on the fuel, I can ignite using the properties of the fuel itself. So that's what a diesel is. And when I do a diesel engine cycle, I tend to be fuel lean. So So I put a lot of air in, and I don't put that much fuel in. And in fact, the fuel-to-air ratio is very similar in a diesel engine as it is in a gas turbine. We consume about half the oxygen during the combustion process. In contrast, you know, your car with a spark-ignited engine, that tends to run at stoichiometric. So your car is designed to run very close to consuming all the oxygen in the cylinder. But one of the downsides to the spark-ignited engine is you regulate then your thrust or the power of the engine, the torque of the engine, by regulating the pressure coming in. So, you know, in a diesel engine, you can just put less fuel in, but still the same amount of air. You have to do the difference. So there's many flavors of engines. I'm going to focus mostly on diesel engines here, but we're getting into an interesting world where the world wants to burn multiple fuels. And then what does your engine want to look like? So it is very interesting. But the same trend we see in gas turbines is happening in reciprocating engines. So we want higher compression ratio and other cycle innovations. So just to get back to some combustion fundamentals, you're all, you know, here for combustion discussion. And our main fuel of choice is a hydrocarbon. So I think this is all, you know, very standard stuff, right? We have fuel and air, and we can, if we're a lean burn engine, our stoichiometric ratio might be 0.5, something like that. If we're a spark-ignited gas engine, it might be 1. But we can calculate pretty quickly the CO2, the water, the nitrogen that comes with the air, and then if there's excess oxygen because you're lean, you know, that's what your products are. And those are your normal products of combustion. And of course, we do worry about CO2, particularly if it's a fossil fuel. But what really drives sort of design and the challenge is sort of all the unintended products of combustion. So, you know, if we think about what comes from the fuel, we have unburned fuel. So that can be just slipped through the engine. And it might not be at the highest power, but it might be during startup or other times. So you worry about unburned hydrocarbons. You worry about soot. And that's kind of related to unburned hydrocarbons, but it's different because it's a particulate. And there are specific health effects due to particulates, especially when they're very small. And then carbon monoxide, of course, is incomplete combustion. And between the carbon monoxide and the oxides of nitrogen, those are the bad guys. And, you know, that's what gives combustion a bad name if you don't handle this stuff right. And that's really the job, you know, our job is to make sure that we minimize all of those undesirable things. So starting from that framework, you know, what are typical numbers? And so it's instructive to think, what are normal numbers here? As I said, if you're doing sort of a gas turbine, this is just a typical emissions. You have nitrogen, of course. That's what air is, mostly nitrogen. If we burn, you know, up to half the oxygen, you'll have this range. These are actually a little bit older numbers. You'll be lower than 12 if you're a very advanced engine. And then, of course, we make some carbon dioxide and we make some water vapor. So that's normal, and depends very much on the design of the cycle itself. And then if we look at nitric oxide, you know, this is a range, it's interesting. We now have commercial engines at large scale, like 100 megawatts, that are commercially guaranteeing 3 ppm only from the combustion process. So it's pretty interesting. And I'll talk more about how you get that. But if you don't do that, you're in the 200s. And if you look at aviation engines, you're more like in the 300s or higher. So, you know, we've made orders of magnitude change in emissions. It's pretty exciting. Nitrogen dioxide is kind of what NOx turns into when it gets a chance, and that's the stuff that turns brown. So it may not be formed in the engine. That may happen in the atmosphere, and it depends a lot on what goes on. What's interesting about nitrogen dioxide, though, and the brown emissions, if you have incomplete combustion and a lot of CO2, there's some very interesting chemical kinetics that drive the reaction of NO to NO2. And you can have a large power plant with a brown plume coming out of it. And people don't like that. So that's a big deal. Carbon monoxide, of course, is a concern, especially if it's near where people are. Sulfur dioxide, you know, we've handled that really as an industry and as a society by minimizing the amount of sulfur in the fuel. In North America, we recently dropped the standards for diesel fuel down to 15 part per million. But if you look at marine fuels, like a marine diesel, there could be 2% by weight, so 20,000 ppm sulfur and higher, right? So sulfur is still a big deal depending on what your fuel source is. Unburned hydrocarbons and then particulate matter. These are the bad guys. So if you're thinking, how do we make an impact? We make an impact by minimizing all those guys. If we look at it, I'm just going to walk through, you know, there's emission requirements and they're all over the place. And there's different language that is spoken in different places, so I'll just walk you through a little bit of that. I sort of think from the science point of view. So PPM is kind of where I think about, you know, what's really going on. But usually when we look at regulations, it's usually amount of NOx produced, often in grams, because they worry about how many tons is going into the atmosphere a year. And so you'll worry about, you know, grams per unit of whatever the engine does, so per megawatt or per horsepower. But here's just some examples of ground-based emissions in the U.S. This is World Bank numbers, and these will be getting more stringent. But I'll focus here on the nitric oxides. You'll see that we actually have different levels depending whether it's a reciprocating engine or whether it's a gas turbine or if it's a boiler. And these boiler guys are getting away with a lot, okay, compared to other ones. As I mentioned, in turbines, very rare for a gas turbine that burns natural gas to be over 42 ppm. And as I said, we have some technology that's 3. A lot of places in the world, I said at the bottom here, that local regulations are often more stringent. You know, California, they go for best available technology as part of their standard. So there's a very interesting dynamic where in a gas turbine that's very efficient, we can't get 3, but we can, say, guarantee 9 ppm. But you can still take that, put that through after treatment, and get down to, you know, 2 or 2.5, which sounds good, but the way you get down is you inject ammonia, and then you have ammonia slip. And then it's a trade. You know, what's worse? Is it better to have a little less NOx but more ammonia, or a little more NOx and no ammonia? So, you know, interesting dynamic there. But this gives you a sense of the numbers. I just wanted, for this session, I wanted to give you a feel for kind of how is this regulated. And World Bank, again, because they are involved in financing a lot of big projects, oftentimes these are the standards that apply. Otherwise, it goes very much by country and often by specific region. So in the U.S., you have so-called non-attainment regions. If you don't attain the targets for things like ozone, and a precursor to ozone is NOx. So if you don't attain what you need to with ozone, then you get very, very tight NOx requirements for the ground-based. Aviation is totally different. You know, airplanes go all over the world, so it's not really regulated at the nation level. Although every now and then Europe and certain countries in Europe have tried to adopt standards, and right now there's an interesting debate going on because Europe wants to put taxes on aircraft or landing fees, basically, if they exceed emissions. And then that becomes a discussion, is that a fair trade issue or not? But what's really exciting from my point of view is that there's been great progress. And the video I showed at the beginning is an example of that. But 81, I should say, was when people first started thinking, hey, what's coming out of aircraft engines? Should we have some sort of regulation? And what's interesting about this standard is it recognizes that if I have a higher pressure ratio, I'm more efficient. And knowing that NOx goes up with temperature, there's kind of a built-in allowance for a little more NOx if you have a higher pressure ratio engine. So the standards do have this slope to them. In a way, you know, I look at this as someone's already done the math to trade NOx with CO2. What's more important? They're both important, but this is a way to say, what's that trade? So what I'm trying to show here, this is just data from the International Civil Aviation Organization. I didn't highlight GE engines on here, but as you saw, in fact, GENX is not on this, and it's well below the points that are listed. But the message here is the manufacturers have responded, and the regulations have gotten tighter. The latest ones were 2008 with CAPE 6, and there's discussion about a next level that would come in before 2020. But the exact timing isn't exactly defined. In fact, the levels aren't defined. That's what's on the next page here. There's sort of, here's the way they now talk about it is what's the margin to Cape 6? Cape 6 is the current international standard. And so there's those dotted lines show 10, 20, 30% reduction levels. And right now, that you know, we're all thinking that somewhere around 50% margin to that Cape 6 is where we want the next level to be. And GE and X engine is pretty much there. I think it's sitting at 40% right now. So there's room to maybe improve. But that's your first lean burn. That's a I'll talk more about that. But that's a technology the world is likely going to move to, especially if you want to go even further. But there is a very interesting dynamic right now. There are multiple ways to get to those levels, multiple architecture. And ultimately, it'll be different design teams, and the market will choose. So switching gears again to locomotives, looking at ground-based. Here we've seen remarkable change as well. So starting back in like, I think it was 1973, what do I have there? Yeah, 73 to 2001, we had so-called Tier Zero. That was kind of the standard, the baseline. And here, NOx is defined as grams per horsepower hour. So that's how I operate the engine. And then particulate matter. So those are the two kind of bad guys plotted on each other. And you can see how the regulations, in 2002, they went to Tier 1, but we got pretty impatient with that, and we jumped to Tier 2. And stood for a long time at Tier 2, which was a significant, almost 50% reduction in NOx and a lot bigger reduction in particulates. And then 7 years went by, and then Tier 3 was established to further reduce particulate emissions, and that was really the concern around particulate matter, PM 2.5 sort of standard. Below that number, those particulates can go into your lungs. And because trains are used a lot around cities, there's a big concern about particulates. But what's remarkable is we're just coming into a time now of so-called Tier 4 standards, which is an enormous reduction to this very low level. And I'll talk at the end. There's actually a product announcement that was recently made on locomotives that meets this goal. So a lot of research and development is driven by meeting these kind of regulations. And I think it's a good thing. It makes these systems cleaner and have less unintended consequences. I should add, it's not all about emissions, though. Of course, if I buy a piece of equipment, how much I pay for it, how reliable it is, these are critical things. And so, it's not about the science of how low I can get. It's really about, how low can I get, but also how practical is it? And is it useful? Will it work the way it's intended to work? And that's a constant struggle. And that's frankly what engineering is all about, is how to make those trades. Biofuels, I talked about this a little bit before, but I think if you're going to have a great biofuel, it's got to result in less carbon. And that's not always obvious. If you look at how methanol gets made, in many places, it's tractors, it's fertilizers based on fossil fuels. So you're really getting to the question of, is it as carbon neutral as you might like to think it is? We need to have it in scale. We really burn an incredible amount of fuel. So when you think about, what it takes to create, a million gallons of fuel, I guess a good example of scale is there's a handful of airports in the U.S. that each put 1 billion gallons of aviation fuel into aircraft each year. So when you're thinking, oh, I want to convert my fleet, well, what would it take to get 1 billion gallons just for one airport like LAX or JFK? That's the scale of the modern world. It's got to be cost effective. If it costs 10 times more, we're probably not going to, you're not going to fly in that airplane if it's 10 times more expensive. And of course, it has to be compatible with fuel production. So, there's been a lot of discussion. There's sort of Gen 1, Gen 2 biofuels. Things like algae, I think, are interesting because we don't think of that as a food source, and the world's 70% water. So, those are the kind of things we've got to think about. And just again, talking about aviation for a minute, if we look at how things have moved, There are, you know, mostly have Jet A. We have a very tight spec on jet fuel because it has to, you know, do all the right things in the engine. Plus, you got to be able to handle and store it. Has to handle cold temperatures. So a lot of requirements on jet fuel. But starting in 2009, a Fischer-Tropsch fuel was approved for use in aircraft. And then approval for HEFA fuel started in 2014. And there's been a number of milestones indicated here. So, you know, the industry, the aviation industry, is embracing the idea of biofuels. It's really a matter of supply and quality. If we think about fuels, you know, I talked about sort of natural gas versus liquid, but gaseous fuels come in many flavors. And so in the middle of this chart is methane, or natural gas, which we use a couple engineering terms here. Heating value on the bottom, we all know what that is. But then this so-called modified Wabi, and this is important when you get into sizing of your combustion system and the orifices and stuff. So you know, I can have a fuel that, for example, if I add more hydrogen, it makes, you know, has higher heating value per pound. Doesn't really change the Wabi number a lot. If I have things that might lead to condensates, so things like ethane and maybe some propane, that kind of stuff, that'll drive me up here. And then if I have gases, COG is coke oven gas or low BTU syngases, they drive me down. And so one of the challenges, if you're a combustion designer, you'd kind of like to say, hey, it can burn gaseous fuel. And then, but someone hands you this and says, make sure it works at all those corner points. And then, you know, does it do all the things you need to do? Can you light it? Can you operate it? Can you bring the engine up? How do the emissions change when I operate these different fuels? So that is a lot of the reality of you know, what we do, is understanding this variation. And it's kind of easy if a customer just has a specific fuel. You can kind of customize for that. But what if they want to switch back and forth? A lot of the energy markets today, you know, you have multiple pipeline systems, and there's daily trading. And depending on the price, a customer will want to buy from this pipeline today and that one tomorrow, sometimes even hour by hour. And they may have different compositions. So that presents some technical challenges to be able to handle that variation. So now I want to talk about combustion systems and some different architectures. And I'll just do a time check here. We're about halfway through, I think, 9:30. And we're going to about 10:15. So I'll just talk about some combustion fundamentals and then how that relates to these three different platforms that I've talked about. And by the way, let me take a moment and say, if you have any questions, you don't need to wait till the end. So before I jump into sort of combustion systems part of this, any questions about trends or any of the stuff that I've discussed so far?
Hold here for a question. You talked about the different generations, or I forget what you called them, in the locomotives. Were those standards or just what people were doing? Or
no, so those are EPA regulations. Okay. So tier 1, 2, 3, 4.
So the states?
The United States.
Okay.
And so I think in Canada tends to, in these cases, you know, agree on the same standards. Europe has different standards. They have a different name, but in the end, they're very similar. And this, what's interesting, you know, cars and trucks, I think you're going to have a speaker talking more about sort of those type of engines. Those standards came in before. So, you know, a lot of the technology that was developed was applied to those engines. And really the challenge to meet some of what I just showed was, how do you scale it? Are those technologies scalable? You know, what makes sense. But yeah, no, those are regular. That's not just what people are doing. It's what does the government say? In order to sell a locomotive, you must have a certificate of compliance.
But that's only for a new locomotive. Like, you don't have to retrofit your fleet or something.
No, you don't. That's right. And actually, the Tier 4 standard was put in about 5 years ago. And I was personally involved in some of the discussions of setting those regulations. And it was very interesting because the EPA has pretty sophisticated models. A locomotive can last 30 years. So when they set the standard, it doesn't mean that emissions are going to drop tomorrow. It just means that as the fleet retires, things are going to get better at a certain rate. Sometimes they will backwards force regulations, but not very often. So usually stuff is grandfathered in. And but it also gets into if there's any modification made. Like, for example, we often will uprate an old engine. And we'll say, hey, we got some new technology that we're putting on new products. If we put that on your old one, you can get a 5% reduction in fuel burn. So there are standards that if you're doing that type of modification, you have to also comply with the new regulation. So yeah, the law tries to be reasonable. And then it gets into interesting of how you implement some of that stuff. But for the most part, yes, it's new make. And you know, I'll just tell you an interesting story about that. When Tier 2 came out, the railroads were very worried. And in fact, they pre-bought. So, you know, if you're a manufacturer, wow, gangbuster year. And then January 1st hits, it's like, wow, nobody wants my stuff, you know. So, you know, you sort of have to, and that's why when we were a little smarter when it came to Tier 4. We said, how do we get the railroads not to be so worried? But when those type of regulations hit diesel engines for trucks, it was profound implications. In fact, a big company like Caterpillar ended up withdrawing from the market. They said, we aren't going to play. Very interesting. So, you know, there's how you handle and what your company response to these regulations is interesting. But trucks are whole interest. I mean, I don't know that world that well, but it's been very interesting as you try to bring new regulations into that space. And it's tough. It can be very, very tough.
Just for a local context, the you know, there's a huge political issue of the trains going to the airport. It's under construction downtown, and I believe they're Tier 4 because they, you know, there's so much controversy about that train line that they agreed to bring in the very best world's technology on that.
Yes. I've got one chart on that for gas turbines, which I'll share. You know, the basic rule of thumb is if you can fix it in the combustion process, that's the best way to do it. So it's always a debate, actually there's a great lead into where I'm going here. There's a great debate about after treatment versus not. Just to share with you the discussion on Tier 4, the assumption we all made, meaning the companies, the railroads, and the EPA, was we'd take our best engine, the Tier 2 engine, and put after treatment on it. That was the basis of setting that standard of 70% reduction. And they kind of wanted 90% because they said, hey, on a good day, an after treatment system does reduce by 90 or 95%, but you have to think through, what about a bad day? What about old equipment? What about, you know, all these other things? So we kind of got them to agree to be reasonable, to say, hey, we all want 90%, but let's do something that's manageable so that we don't have fleets that are you know, not working. And then, in fact, you're using the old engines more if the new ones don't work. So there's this whole sort of trade-off that gets done. I'll jump to a punchline on the Tier 4, though. This is engineering, and this is the power of smart people. We were able to achieve Tier 4 without after-treatment, either on NOx or particulates. I would not have guessed that 5 years ago. That is the power of R&D. So it's pretty cool. And it really comes down to, you know, what is the lowest cost way to do stuff? And if you're all going to be combustion engineers, do it in the combustion process. Let's be clever about the combustion part and not need all the other systems. But that's a great question. I have some more. Any other questions?
Yeah, there might be people here who aren't as familiar with the modified lobby index. Maybe you could just discuss what that is.
Yeah, so that really gets into, you know, I had heating value on one axis, and that's really a measure of the volumetric flow of fuel through an orifice, because a lot of what we do, you end up having to size for pressure drop and other stuff, and so it's important to know the volume of fuel that you're pushing through a system, and lobby number is basically density normalized, and modified means you take temperature into account, but it's really a density normalization. But if you get into a question of hot fuel versus cold fuel, we also talk about modified wabi. So it's really just, what's the volumetric flow for given, you know, say I want to make a 1 megawatt gas turbine, how much fuel do I need? Then you get into, what's the volumetric flow I have to put through the pipes? And that's what the wabi number means.
That's
Yes.
You mentioned EU and EPA standards. How about the rest of the world, like Asia? What do they do? Do they have a governing body that brings regulations in?
Some, you know, if you think about it, if you're an equipment manufacturer, you're going to kind of design stuff for the markets. And then it depends who's the bigger market. What I've observed, so it can be different, and I think China right now is really struggling with this because I showed you pictures of the air quality. I mean, it's really not a happy story. And I've personally been in Beijing and Shanghai, and it's tough. So I think China is thinking about what to do, but I will give an example. Generally, they're pushing now for the best available technology. So we provided the locomotives that there was a new train line going from I think Beijing, somewhere in the main part of the country, to Nepal, to Lhasa. And that was a very interesting question because that's a locomotive going to 16,000 feet. So it's almost like an aircraft engine, so having a reciprocating engine at high altitude. But they wanted the latest standard engine. And that's actually, frankly, partly why we, I think, won the contract. We had lower emissions product. And so I don't know exactly, you know, China doesn't have the equivalent of EPA that I'm aware of, but they tend to look around and they'll try to be consistent with EPA or US. And part of that's just reality. You know, unless they're a huge market themselves, you're not going to get equipment manufacturers to customize the product too much. So they tend to move somewhat in concert. I'm not aware of a regulation that drove that decision. But I think it is a mentality of, hey, we need to be, you know, setting the pace. And frankly, they also wanted access to new technology like that. So they have kind of two reasons to want to have the best stuff. Okay, so now I'm just going to walk through. I've talked a lot about how NOx, you know, varies with temperature, and I think you all know this stuff probably. You know, this is combustion 101 type of stuff. So obviously, as you vary equivalence ratio, if you're fuel lean, it's less than one. If you're fuel rich, it's greater than one. And the highest temperature, obviously, is at around stoichiometric. And so there's really two strategies if you're thinking about how to reduce NOx. One is to be on the rich side. I'm just trying to get my mouse here. Here we go. Either go on the rich side because I have a lower flame temperature, and my rate of NOx production is lower. This is sort of a rate of NOx reduction here, so dNOx dT. So if I can be over here or if I can be over here, I'm gonna minimize my NOx. And there are combustion systems, so-called rich quench lean. So I can have a rich head end. I can quickly inject a bunch of air and quench it and sort of tunnel. Sorry, I'm not seeing my mouse. So if I have a beginning of a combustor here, quickly add a bunch of air to jump over here, then I keep my combustion temperatures low. The other way is simply just to premix it and to premix it before it burns and never have the potential for high temperature. Those are the basic two competing technologies. And I've seen both in products, they both work. I think for entitlement, the best you can do, it's more around the lean side, but you do hit limits. What's not on this chart is obviously, there's flammability limits. If I'm too rich or too lean, I can suffer from blowout. The other thing that I just want to point out about this that, you know, NOx, it's really, if I take air to high temperatures, I make NOx, and that's the so-called Zeldovich mechanism, and you've probably all heard about Zeldovich, and that's really the main mechanism. So if I can reduce the resin, you know, right away, if you think about the fundamentals, you can think about what you want to do. I want to premix. I want to have shorter residence times. Those are the drivers, you know, that you'll see. There are other types of NOx mechanisms, so-called prompt NOx. And that was actually someone at GE, at the place I work, did some very interesting experiments in the 70s where they measured NOx through just a simple flame and made a fundamental discovery. They first, of course, I think, first of all, they thought that might be a measurement error. But they got more NOx at the front of the flame than they expected. You know, if you're expecting sort of NOx to form versus time, make a measurement, and you get more NOx at the front. It's like, what's going on? And that becomes, those are the reactions between hydrocarbon radicals with nitrogen. Either C or CH or CH2 plus nitrogen are the so-called prompt NOx reactions. And it's prompt NOx, so they get it ahead of when I expected to. In the end, that's not a big contributor to NOx formation. And then fuel by nitrogen, again, depending on your fuel source, you can have high levels of nitrogen in fuel. And if you, the bad thing about a lean burn combustion system is if I have high fuel by nitrogen, most of that nitrogen will get converted to NOx. So if I know I have a fuel with 5% fuel by nitrogen, I don't want to do a lean burn system. So, you know, your choice of fuels, you know, really makes a difference to what strategy you would take to design a system. But that curve applies to any engine. You know, that's why it's a great to remember that one. So I just pulled off, you know, this is the EPA website. EPA does a nice job when they set regulations. They do look at the reality and take that to some extent. But they're also looking at health effects. And they're really biased by protecting people's health. So it's an interesting trade-off. So this is for a gas turbine. You know, what are your options for reducing NOx? So going back to that curve, reducing peak temperature, obviously that's a big deal. Reducing residence time is a big deal. And there's, you know, techniques available. There's chemical reduction of NOx, so-called SCR. That's ammonia reduction. That's what I was mentioning earlier. And then there's selective non-catalytic reduction. Those are other ways of reducing NOx. And then, you know, they put low NOx burners in here kind of twice. I'm not sure that low NOX burners fit into that. I guess, I'll show you one example where that's true. If I have staged combustion, then I can reduce it by having a burner. But here's the chart, going back to Jim's question, of what do you want to do. This is a cost impact versus approach. And the units here are what, cents per kilowatt hour. And that's actually, like, that's what we pay for power. So if you're more than a penny per kilowatt hour, that's huge. That's a really big cost, okay? And you can see things like a low temperature SCR. And this is what's the problem now for coal plants. Coal plants are expected to have things like SCRs, and they're just very expensive. So what's interesting in this whole plot, that's why I put the blue box here, doing, you know, DLN, I'll talk more about that, is dry low NOx, and that's basically modifying the combustion process itself. And that's the best. There are other ways, if you can read it here, WS injection means water or steam injection. I can have my old combustor that maybe wasn't very premixed, had high flame temperatures. If I put a lot of diluent in there, I can reduce the flame temperatures. So another conventional strategy is steam or water injection. And there the cost is quite variable, depends on the cost of your water. But in many parts of the world, we are very constrained by water. And to put water into an engine, it has to be clean. It can't make a lot of deposits and scale it up. So you need not only the water, but the water treatment system. So water injection is not a good method in many places. But where water is, you know, cheap and clean, it's a viable technology. But again, as a designer, as a combustion design guy, you know, I'd much rather modify the combustion system. And if we can deal with all the challenges, then it's a great product and it's very cost effective. So, you know, what are those approaches to how you get low emissions? So fundamentally, it's get the fuel mixed with the air. So typical, you know, the original sort of gas turbine, I'll show you some different architectures, but one is to have a big can combustor. And if you look at what was done, you know, 20 years ago, there's one big fuel nozzle in the middle, and it just puts the fuel out there, kind of like your home furnace, but at much bigger scale. And when you do that, your combustion is limited by the mixing between the fuel and the air. So it tends to burn where you're at stoichiometric conditions, and you get the hottest flames, the fastest reaction rates, and the highest NOx. So that was one injector per can. I'll talk about some new systems, but fundamentally, if I have six burners in a can, and each burner has 30 injection holes, and maybe I have 15 or 18 cans around an engine, I have a lot of fuel injection points. I have a lot of ways for fuel to intimately mix with the air before it burns. So that's a big one. You know, when we think about combustors, I haven't talked about that yet, but you know, combustion systems, I want to put the air through and burn, but I also have to protect the equipment and the combustion liners. So in the old days, I could just put a ton of air on the liner and make it nice and cold. Life was good. But now that air has a cost. If I could move it to the head end and premix it, I can get lower emissions. But if I do too much of that, my liner materials get too hot, and then I have a reliability problem. So a real trade on how to manage that. And then if you do premix fuel with air, you have to do staging. I'll give you an example of that. And staging is complicated. There's valves, there's controls. This is part of the complexity that we'd like to avoid, but we do live with. So at the bottom of this page, there's really two charts. One is sort of our key constraints. So if I do go to low emissions combustion, I'm doing it to get NOx, and I'm doing it, that becomes a fundamental requirement. I can't sell a piece of equipment if I don't make the emissions. So we can't sort of say, I'll let NOx go up by 30% because it makes something else better. That's my limit. CO is also regulated. So it's regulated a little bit differently, but in the end, I have to meet those numbers. And those are the unintended products of combustion. And so what are the challenges? Well, the challenge is, how do I turn down an engine? How do I make it run at its full rated condition, but also run at low power? How do I start it? How do I start on a cold day? So all of that turn down is one of the huge engineering challenges. And then dynamics, what we mean there is combustion fluctuations. If I have a candle, a diffusion flame, it burns pretty steady. As soon as I premix and get like a blue Bunsen burner flame, try putting a Bunsen burner into a tube, a Reiki tube, and you can get some amazing tones coming out of it in something as simple as that. Just confine a premix flame in an acoustic cavity. And fundamentally, that's what we have in a gas turbine. So we have a confined flame, we have an acoustic cavity, and it will excite at certain operating conditions. So dynamics is one of the major challenges to successfully designing a low emissions engine. And you know, this is another way to look at it. This is obviously the classic chart of either NOx or CO as a function of that either flame temperature or equivalence ratio. The sweet spot is somewhere around phi of a half, and there's a range. If I go higher, I make more NOx, and if I get lower, my CO goes up. Now, if life were good, if I could just always change the amount of air to match it so I sat in this green spot, it would be great. But if we look at equipment like gas turbines are volumetric devices. They suck in air, and the amount of air they pull, they're like a big fan. So they pull in air as a function of speed. Well, if I'm trying to have a big machine connected to a grid, I need to fix that rotation speed to the grid, say 3,600 RPM or some multiple, so that I can produce power at the right frequency. Well, now I have a machine that's, but maybe I don't want all the power that machine can produce. Maybe the grid only needs 50% power. So now I got a whole lot of air, and I only want to put in half the fuel that I would normally need. How do you do that? And how do you stay within these limits? Because if I didn't have any staging, I would suddenly be at a phi of 0.25. And that's kind of what maybe the cycle would require. Same amount of air going through the system. I need half the power. Roughly, I have half the fuel. So that's where staging and turn down becomes very important. And I'll talk more about that. In fact, I think I got a video coming up that explains one way of staging that helps. So here's, I just got some pictures of gas turbines. There are different system architectures. So it's always interesting to see why do people build things different ways and what choices get made. There's a so-called silo combustor. That's one big combustor, kind of like that chart I showed, literally a compressor, a combustor, and a turbine. So there are designs where you have just one combustor. The main problem with those is you have to, in the end, put the air into the annulus of the turbine, and it's hot gas. So how do I feed that air, and how do I get uniform temperature, and how do I have more metal that has to guide that hot air? So there are some, that's more of, I'll say, an older technology. Not that many new units being made with silo combustors. The very first combustion systems, if you remember that very first page I showed with the early jet engines, they were can annular. They were chambers, and we call them cans because they kind of look like a can, and they were arranged around the annulus of the turbine. And so that was sort of the favorite approach at the very, very beginning. And one reason was I could just test one can. And if I got that to be happy, I could propagate it, make 10 or 12, and that would be my combustion system. that thinking still persists on the biggest engines today. And one of the reasons is, you know, it's pretty expensive to run combustion tests. But if I can run one, if I have 18 chambers and I only have to develop one of the 18 at a time, that's a big savings. Most of our machines are so-called CAN annular for big ones. But obviously, that's extra metal, that's extra weight. If I'm an aircraft engine, they pretty quickly move to an annular combustor. So it's just a big annulus. And that's like that video you saw at the beginning. Those are the three main styles. I'm showing you here a picture of a 7FB gas turbine. And that has a so-called DLN 2.6. The six means it's got six fuel nozzles per chamber. And there are some of the characteristics it's a 23 pressure ratio. Again, pretty high for industrial. One of the reasons it's not higher is you really want to match that to the bottoming cycle, which is a steam turbine. And I didn't mention this when we looked at TS diagram, but if I go to too high a compression ratio, when I expand the hot gases, it gets cold. Now, for an aircraft engine, that's good, because I don't have a bottoming cycle. So I don't mind if the exhaust gas is a bit colder. But if I'm trying to connect it to a bottoming cycle, and if my material for the bottoming cycle is water or steam, I really need to match it. So that's one of the reasons we pick those kind of pressure levels. But that's a basic gas turbine architecture. And there's been a real evolution. So I mentioned that the very first ones were like one can with one fuel nozzle. Pretty quickly, we got into sort of multiple cans. So here we have the, this was actually called a multi-nozzle quiet combustor. It turned out it was happier if it had a few smaller flames. And we still use this today for low BTU fuels. Excellent performance on low BTU fuels. But the problem is it's rich burning, can be very high NOx. It is highly fuel flexible. That's why we like it for these low heating value fuels. And there's no staging. Pretty simple system. If we look at DLN1, they basically took that same idea, but they put a Venturi in the middle to accelerate the flow. And this is a very interesting concept where you can have flame in the upstream part, so it's all thermally, the liner has the right cooling and materials and all that. But because of that Venturi, at low load I run it like I would a normal diffusion combustor, but at high load I can push the flame out. And I've got a video I'll show next, but the schematic is shown below, that at different load points you can have the flame in different places. And ultimately, it's really very clever, I can push the flame out of the head end and just have flame downstream. And then what was my first combustor is now a premixer. So that was the first generation. And in fact, as we've improved that over the last 20 years, there's a version of this which makes 3 ppm NOx. It's really outstanding performance. But we did find limitations when we went to that. Remember I showed you E class, F class, H class? As you went from E to F, there were some problems with this combustor. It just didn't really have the entitlement, the capability. So then we went, and the industry has done, not just GE, the industry has really moved to fully premixed systems, and that's so-called DLN2. And there, at higher firing temperatures, you can get between 9 and 25. And this is a cross-section of the combustor, and the bottom here is a cross-section of the fuel injector. Basically, there's a long tube down the middle for starting, for pilot fuel. And then there's fuel injection upstream, about halfway down that part. And there's an air swirler there, and fuel comes out of the throw vanes and mixes. So you have a pre-mixing region before you get combustion. So just to give you an example of fuel staging, here's a short video just showing how, imagine if I had a machine and I'm starting it from ground idle or spinning reserve up to full power. So there's no audio on this one, but you can see you light off, you get combustion in the head end, you can also put fuel down that middle, down that center body, and then you can see you can put all the fuel down the center body, get rid of the fuel upstream until the flame goes out. Once the flame's out, add fuel upstream, and then I'll play it one more time. So you light off. So the main point is that center body can handle all the fuel flow, but eventually you put fuel back upstream. So there you have flame only on that center body, but then you put fuel upstream, and then you get flame holding between both. And you optimize the split of fuel between here and here to get very, very low emissions. So that's an example of, you know, you can't just design a system. You have to design a system that can handle these different operating requirements. So I just wanted to show another one. You know, there are many flavors of gas turbines and combustion systems. One that's really quite interesting is the Alstom GT2426. And it's interesting because it's a so-called reheat gas turbine. So if you go back to Thermo 101, I showed you a TS diagram. Well, if I expand, compress again, and expand, then I can get more power out of the same carcass. It doesn't necessarily make me more efficient, but if I have a bottoming cycle, it can. And but from a combustion point of view, it's actually very interesting because you have your this, and in this particular chart, the flow is from right to left. But you have here they've got an annular combustor that's low emissions. There's a different style, so-called EV burner, but it's like the, as, you know, basically fuel is injected and has an opportunity to mix with the air before the combustion zone. But what's novel about this is there is a stage for expansion and then a stage for a sequential injection. And this is very clever because there are NOx reburning reactions. If I have hydrocarbon fragments that I inject later, they will react with the NOx and get rid of it. So the second burner, I think, is also known as a no-NOx burner because the NOx coming out is roughly the same as the NOx coming in. And those are some of the tricks that you can play. If you're trying to get low NOx, you can think through, how can I imagine, with the constraints that you're given, how can I get to very low emissions? So this is how Alstom chose to do it. So it has interesting point of view from thermodynamics. It's also very interesting from a combustion point of view. Injecting fuel into a hot gas that doesn't have its full oxygen is an interesting challenge. How do you get it to mix before it burns and some of that? So I'm going to switch gears back to aviation type engines. And again, the same theme of more fuel injection points, more air to the combustion dome and fuel staging. I showed that movie about the GENX engine. Just to show you there's different ways that, you know, we've thought about this problem and dealt with it. There's a GE90, which I showed at the very beginning. That's what powers the 777. It actually has a dual dome design, so there's two fuel injectors. And what that means is that when you start, you can, for example, and I forget which one starts first, but you can turn one on, and the air just goes through. And so that's how you can handle, you know, you have staged combustion. And that's very effective for at low power. You have one burner on, at high power you have two. But you're always mixing the air pretty well with the fuel in either of those two modes. Rolls-Royce has a design with a very interesting sort of pilot, and then some sort of, not exactly pre-mixing, but it's a leaner head end. Combustor dome is what we call the front of the combustor, the front face. So they've moved a little more air, but they've still got, if you can see in this picture, they've still got cooling technology in these big holes. So it's still, at some conditions, rich, and there's a bunch of air that comes in to quench, and then the rest of the combustion. But that is a leaner head end, and that's one of the strategies they've used to get to low emissions and be competitive. So, you know, it's always very interesting for me to look at how, you know, different people in different parts of the world solve the same problem. And the challenge is, you know, what's the most effective, the lowest cost, the most reliable. So if I look at the same story about how to have things evolved, I put on here a similar family of engines, the first two. CFM56, this is an engine that is almost exclusively on the Boeing 737. So Boeing 737s are narrow body aircraft, and if you're doing short, you know, 1 to 5 hour flights, often that's a 737, and it's a CFM. So what's interesting is the CFM56, so SAC means single annular combustor. That was the baseline design, and it met about 54% of CAPE 2. That was actually improved. It used to be worse than that when it was first introduced. It has no staging, and it has, I mean, that's, those numbers are kind of dated, millions and millions of hours of operation. Now, there were certain customers in Europe, Switzerland and Sweden, I believe, that wanted to have lower NOx, and so they kind of wanted special technology. So a double annular combustor was designed for that, and delivered, and that, actually that one was done before the GE90 that I showed you. So it's kind of an evolution among different product families. But that double annular combustor was effective, but it wasn't as reliable. It had some issues. And then we learned, we got smarter about how to actually improve, and that's, you'll notice tech insertion, tech in means tech insertion. This one actually got pretty close to emissions of this double annular, but still very simple. And that tech insertion was also a little bit higher performance engine. It boosted up the efficiency a little bit. So this is, so the DAC is still in use, but only in certain places. It's not widespread. And then I showed you the video about the GENX, and that one, as I said, it's about 42% of CAPE 6. It's almost meeting those future standards. And that's where we want to be. We want to, you know, I want to be part of a team that is well ahead of the regulations, not just getting there just in time. So it's great, but it isn't easy. Operability is a challenge, and durability, cost, and weight. Especially in the aircraft world, it's a tight, tight design space. And we always kind of say, you know, is there a window, or do all the constraints come in that there's no viable design space? So the job of engineers is to make sure there is a design space to be able to operate inside. But pretty exciting. This has been just a fantastic story over the last 20 years. And it continues. That journey continues. And I'll show you some stuff later. So, you know, what's coming? I don't know if Pulsat Nations are coming. I spent a bunch of time working on it. I've got another session coming up where I'll go into a lot more detail. What's exciting from a combustion point of view, it's a completely different form of combustion. So from a science point of view, it's really cool. And there is potential for more efficiency here as well. But the challenges in terms of durability and emissions and noise and all those practical things are frankly the challenge to moving this technology forward. But as a basic fundamentals, can you do it? You know, stay tuned for my talk later today. That's my sales pitch. Okay, just let me check time here. We got about 10 minutes left, so which is good. I'm right about where I want to be. This is industrial reciprocating engine, so different world. And I just want to share with you that it's pretty interesting where these machines apply. So you can make a large, as I said, each cylinder, that circle, is one power head assembly. So there's one piston inside and one fuel injector and set of valves. In this particular engine I'm showing, that's about 375 horsepower. So the whole engine makes about 4,000 horsepower in a V12 configuration. So that would sit inside a locomotive. So if you see a locomotive going down the tracks, you can imagine the reciprocating engine inside. And when you look at a locomotive, chances are it's a GE locomotive. The other main company in the US is called EMD, Electromotive Division, and they were a part of GM for many years. They were recently acquired by Caterpillar, which is an interesting change for them. And frankly, it will be good for them because that's a bigger company with a lot more experience at that scale. But these engines not only can be used for locomotives, they can be used, this is an example of a tugboat. So it's really interesting to see all the places these kind of stuff gets used. But we have to worry about emissions here too. And think about that, especially trains. They're in cities, as Murray said. They're in harbors. And guess what? Harbors are where people are. So, you know, emissions become a big deal. The days when I grew up, lots of black smoke coming from diesel engines. Much, much less of that today. And so if you look at the NOx control technologies for internal combustion engines, you know, these are some of the ones that are identified. And basically, they come down to two classes. What can I do in cylinder? What do I do as after treatment? That's the basic trade. And if you look at, you know, what we've been able to accomplish, I'm proud to say we've been able to do a lot of it just with the combustion technology. If you look at cars, it's very interesting. You'll hear about technology like BlueTEC. I think Mercedes has BlueTEC, which is really an ammonia reduction system on their reciprocating diesel engine. But I heard recently Mazda, I know Mazda in Japan, gets similar emissions with no aftertreatment. And they were going to roll it out in the US, but I don't know if that's happened. But it's very interesting, again, from a combustion science point of view, you know, who's solving the problem in the engine and who's solving it outside the engine, and what does that mean, and who's more competitive. So if we look at the combustion process, I really like this chart. This gives tremendous insight as to what's going on in an engine. Typical diesel combustion, first of all, I'll acquaint you with the coordinate system here. Equivalence ratio locally around where the fuel is mixing and reacting with the air versus the temperature of that particle. So imagine this is, you're a lump of air or a lump of fuel. What do you experience during a reciprocating engine cycle? So typically, you know, we inject fuel into air and it very quickly starts to mix, but it's very high equivalence ratio. So here's a, you know, equivalence ratio of 6. So I'm trying to get my mouse to move here. So in this coordinate, obviously it starts at almost infinity, right? It's pure fuel. But pretty quickly, before it reacts, it starts to mix with the air. But as it mixes with the air, it does start to react. So it's mixing and reacting at the same time. And this blue line represents kind of one path that you can imagine a particle would go through, a packet would go through. That it's mixing with air, it's dropping its equivalence ratio, but it's getting hotter and it's reacting. And what's interesting is there's an island there, this soot island. So if I go in the middle of that, I'm going to be forming a huge amount of particulates. So I don't really want to be there. But diesel, if I don't mix as well as I would like, I run the risk of having a lot of my combustion happen at an equivalence ratio of 1. And as we know, that's where the peak temperature is. So on this plot, you can see I'm making a lot of my NOx here. And then during an expansion stroke, it cools off. So that's kind of a trajectory, and there's two islands, this soot island and this NOx island. So if I'm designing the combustion process, that's kind of the constraints. That's my landscape that I think about. And I can also put on here spark ignition engine, because there they're premixed, and there it's about equivalence ratio of 1. And you can see here that that's not a great place from a NOx point of view, but that helps explain why you seldom have a problem with particulates in a gasoline engine. It's not getting into that kind of regime. Now, one of the reasons spark ignition engines sit there is because if you consume all the oxygen, there's been great progress in the so-called three-way catalyst. So I can have a catalyst system that if I don't have too much oxygen around, it can effectively reduce the NOx, the CO, and the Enbrin hydrocarbons. And that's the basis of why we have cleaner burning cars. So that's a key. That aftertreatment is a key part of why you operate at that condition. So that's kind of the lay of the land. If you just think about, you know, if I'm designing the cycle, what would I do? How can I think about it? So if we look at some of the things that have been done, I really want to get that mixing to happen fast. I don't want to have this lump of fluid that's not mixing well that's in that soot regime. So how do I get through that quickly? Well, one way is to inject faster. And how do I inject faster? With higher pressure. How do I do higher pressure? Well, instead of having sort of a mechanical injector, there's been tremendous progress. And this is actually pretty exciting, sort of merging between electromechanical systems, combustion, and controls, so-called high-pressure common rail, where we're now pumping up fluid around the engine upwards of 2,000 bar. And even higher. So 2,000 atmospheres. And think about that. It's one thing on a car or a truck engine. They've been doing that for a while. Think about doing that when your fuel pipe's, you know, an inch in diameter, 2 inches in diameter on a really big engine. So that's extremely high pressures. But the value of that, if I have the right type of injector, I can now pulse my fuel. And maybe during the injection part, I not just having one pulse, but I can tailor it. Or maybe I can tailor it as a function of load. So having very, very high pressures gives me great mixing. And having electronic motion of the needle, I can really tune how I inject the fuel. So common rail has been a huge enabler to designing a combustion recipe to get to low emissions. So, you know, there's some challenges here. Repeatability, if I have 12 cylinders, do they all act the same? There's many factors from a design point of view, many, many parameters now to examine, because I have each load point that I want, but I also have geometry, and I have all this electronic control, which is almost infinite. So imagine now someone saying, give me the best optimized combustion recipe, and you say, well, where do I start? So you have an engine, maybe you have some simulation tools, or you have an engine, but there's just many factors to optimize. How do you do that smartly? And so that's where there's a lot of variancing activity. But common rail has been a huge part of making these engines much cleaner burning. Another option, and you see this in engines as well, is to take the exhaust gas and to recirculate it. And if you do this well, you know, it can be great. I have less oxygen around, so my peak temperatures aren't as high. So that's also a great way to reduce the emissions that you make. And you know, this is adding some complexity, but I would argue less complexity than an after-treatment system that requires another fluid like ammonia. But there are many ways to do EGR, internal EGR, external EGR. If it's external, it comes out of the engine. Do I cool it and then pump it up? Do I pump it back to high pressure and then cool it? So this box over here really is just a discussion of, I have choices. When someone says I have EGR, that's only the beginning of the discussion. There's many ways to think about implementing EGR, and they all have implications on how the system will perform. But the basic idea is shown at the bottom here. If I have normally, and this is actually a very interesting fact about reciprocating engines, just by changing timing, I can change my efficiency versus my NOx. So that's what, and the B stands for brake NOx or brake specific fuel consumption. So if I have a baseline point, I can move up and down a blue line just by changing timing. And so if I have a limit, I can just get myself to where I need to be, but I'm trying to preserve fuel burn. And that's all about when I inject the fuel with respect to the timing of the stroke. And something like common rail enables that, because older engines were mechanical and just kind of were all geared and linked together. But with electronic control, you can now move up and down that line. EGR then shifts the whole curve. And those are always the cool things in combustion. When can you shift the whole curve? And you can ride a different curve. And you can either ride it to get better efficiency, or you can ride it to get better NOx. So those are some of the ways that you can get lower emissions. And I just wanted to share some recent announcement. I just pulled this kind of stuff off the web. But GE has announced, you know, this cut in emissions. That latest change from tier 3 to tier 4 is 70% in NOx and particulates. And it's pretty exciting. One of the things we like about it, because we're doing it in cylinder, our customers were telling us they would have to spend $1.5 billion on all the infrastructure to handle after-treatment systems. The ammonia systems, all the depots, all the effects on their operations. By not requiring that, we've saved them a ton of money. So that's good. And we also, as it turns out, we don't need particulate filter as well. So, you know, this is a big deal. And I will say I give tons of credit to engineering teams. This is what engineering R&D is all about, is doing something that we didn't expect. The other thing I'll just point out here, it's written on this lower one. You know, as we talk about fuels, there's also interest in liquefied natural gas as a fuel for trains. So a lot of interest in having probably a separate tender car. And the railroads really like the idea of choices. If you look in the US at the cost of natural gas compared to liquid fuel, it's like a factor of 4 or 5, depending on the exact market conditions. So and fuel burn is one of their biggest expenses. In airlines, I know it's over 40% of the cost of running an airline is the fuel bill. And I think with locomotives, it's something similar. So if I have a fuel that's 1/5 the price, wow, I'm interested, even if I have to build up some infrastructure. So again, from a combustion now point of view, how do you do that? How can we imagine an engine? How would that play with emissions? So those are, when you think about trends for the future, That's a pretty exciting one. So I think I'm just about done. So let me just give you a couple more charts. As we think about going to the future, there's this whole region. It was green on the other one. In fact, I think I'll build it here. This whole region of low temperature combustion. So if you think about where do you want to be, we really want to be in that green zone, below where soot gets made, colder than where NOx gets made. So even though I'm thrilled about what we've done on Tier 4, we can do even better in the future. So that's the exciting part. There's still headroom here to improve. So if I just talk about gaps, this is my last chart. Advanced cycles. We need fundamental combustion data at relevant conditions. So as we go to higher pressure ratios, you say, is there fundamental flame speed data? Is there fundamental auto-ignition data? Is there fundamental mixing data at engine relevant conditions? And the world has moved faster than a lot of the underlying science. So that's it. Understanding highly turbulent combustion and supersonic combustion. I'll talk more about PDEs and supersonic combustion. That's an area that we don't know a whole lot about. And then, multi-physics design tools. The length scales and time scales important for combustion are almost unparalleled when you think about physics problems. We do care about almost nanoseconds. We do care about, interactions between molecules. On the other hand, we have practical combustion systems. That large industrial gas turbine is about a meter long. So think of how many orders of magnitude we care about, both in time and space, and think of the computational challenge. So I'll talk a little bit about computations in the next talk, but that's, that's the challenge. In emissions, I think we're reaching entitlement, and how do we get better? If I want a more advanced engine, I can burn hotter, but now I've got more NOx. How do we handle that? So that's a real challenge. And then fuel flexible. We don't really have all the underlying chemical kinetic models for the fuels of interest. And then we get to mixed modes of combustion. What if I'm mixing fuels? And now, I have a tuned up reaction mechanism for this fuel, but not for that fuel. How do I model that? So, I have two final thoughts for you. One is that we need multi-physics design tools anchored with data. That's very important. And it's very interesting now, additive manufacturing. I don't know how much you've heard about it, but I've got a great example to share later. It enables faster design cycles. And there's this whole, if I'm trying to design something I need to iterate, do I iterate computationally, or do I iterate with things like I can make parts faster with more freedom than I had before? So those are my final thoughts, and I'll open up to any other questions.
Thank you, Tony.